Of the dimensions of the pelvis, let's deal with the dimensions of the superior pelvic aperture. We have the anteroposterior diameter, which is the distance between the upper part of the symphysis pubis and the middle point of the promontory of the sacrum. This is also called the conjugate diameter, and it is about 11 centimeters. The transverse diameter is the widest transverse diameter between the two linear terminalis, and it is the widest diameter of the inlet, equal to 13.5 centimeters. The oblique diameter is the distance between one sacroiliac joint and the opposite iliopubic eminence, and it is about 12.5 centimeters. You can see that the widest diameter is the transverse diameter. Of the outlet, the transverse diameter is the distance between the two ischial tuberosities, and it is about 11 centimeters. The anteroposterior diameter is the diameter between the lower border of the symphysis pubis and the tip of the sacrum. Because of the mobility of the coccyx, usually the sacrum is used. It is the widest diameter, and it is about 13.5 centimeters. So you can see that in the typical female pelvis, the widest diameter of the inlet is the transverse diameter, while the widest diameter of the outlet is the anteroposterior diameter. Some of these diameters can be assessed clinically, whether directly or indirectly. The anteroposterior diameter, or the conjugate diameter, can be assessed indirectly, that is by PV examination, by passing the index and middle finger per vaginum, and if the middle finger touches the promontory of the sacrum, then the distance can be measured between the promontory of the sacrum and the lower border of the symphysis pubis. This is called the diagonal conjugate diameter, and it is about 1.5 centimeter longer than the true conjugate diameter. This is the diagonal conjugate diameter. It is about 1.5 centimeter longer than the true conjugate diameter. If the pelvis is capacious, then the middle finger will not be able to touch the promontory of the sacrum. Clinically, the subpubic angle can also be assessed. In the female pelvis, with a wide subpubic angle, it should accommodate four fingers. During PV examination, the finger can be swept over the concavity of the sacrum, and an estimate can be made of the degree of concavity of the sacrum. Laterally, in the lateral pelvic wall, the ischial spine can be palpated, and the distance between the two ischial spines can be assessed. This distance is very important. It constitutes what we call the interspinous diameter, and the plane of the ischial spine is called the interspinous plane, or the plane of least pelvic dimensions. The ischial spines will produce a problem during delivery if they are less than 9.5 centimeters apart. Also clinically, the distance between the two ischial tuberosities can be assessed by putting a fist on the perineum at the line, or the transverse line, passing through the anus. And this can assess the distance between the two ischial tuberosities, which constitutes the transverse diameter of the outlet. Of the dimensions of the fetus, the dimensions of the head are the most important because it is the least compressible part. During delivery, the long diameter of the fetal head, which is called the occipitofrontal diameter, engages or passes through the superior pelvic aperture in the transverse plane, because the transverse diameter is the longest diameter of the superior pelvic aperture. So it doesn't engage in the anteroposterior diameter, but it engages in the transverse diameter. And as it descends into the pelvic cavity, it undergoes a 90 degree rotation, so that once it reaches the pelvic outlet, it, the longest diameter of the head lies in the longest diameter of the pelvic outlet, and that is the anteroposterior diameter, and then it is delivered. So during delivery, the fetal head will undergo a 90-degree rotation. It engages in the transverse diameter of the pelvic inlet and appears through the anteroposterior diameter of the pelvic outlet. This rotation of the fetal head is provided by the contraction of levator ani muscle, which forms the pelvic diaphragm. This is how levator ani muscle forms the funnel-shaped pelvic diaphragm. The contraction of these muscle fibers, they cause the rotation of the fetal head during its descent through the birth canal.
Pelvimetry is the assessment of pelvic dimensions. It can be assessed clinically, but it's better to be assessed using imaging techniques. Accurate information can be obtained from plain films, CTs, or MRIs. Here you can see the CT showing the true conjugate diameter from the symphysis pubis to the promontory of the sacrum. And here is the important interspinous diameter, which is the distance between the two ischial spines. This is a transverse section. The distance between the two ischial spines should not be less than 9.5 centimeter, otherwise it will produce problems during delivery. In the other series of images, they show an MRI. This is a sagittal MRI showing the true conjugate diameter, which is the anteroposterior diameter of the pelvic inlet, and it also shows the anteroposterior diameter of the pelvic outlet. This is a highly contracted pelvis. Here it is a transverse section showing the intertubercular diameter, the transverse diameter of the pelvic outlet. These are the ischial tuberosities. And this is another transverse section showing the ischial spines here and measuring the distance between the two ischial spines. It is 8.5 centimeter, much less than the supposed to be 9.5 centimeter. So this is a highly contracted pelvis.